Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome. My name is Frank McQuillan from Pivotal, and it's a pleasure to have you all here and in the room as well as watching the live stream. I'm here to talk to you about a couple of topics. Actually, the first one, our topics are, first of all, Apache MADlib on Greenplum database. I'm going to give you an overview and a demo of this machine learning library, this open source machine learning library. And then I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Anirudh, who's going to walk us through a cybersecurity use case, which describes in practice how a data practitioner would use tools like MADlib and an MPP, a scale-out parallel database like Greenplum, in order to solve for a cybersecurity use case. So I'm going to start with a brief overview and demo of Apache MADlib on Greenplum. So machine learning is moving with gusto to the enterprise. These technologies are not just used in academia anymore. They're not just for Silicon Valley companies. They're actually becoming mainstream. And it's okay. So in both specialty press and the popular press, they're getting a lot of coverage, and it's warranted because these technologies have the the promise to improve products and services that enterprises are offering to their customers, and also providing them with a competitive advantage in the marketplace. So this is apparent in the revenue forecasts that analysts are putting out there around, including this one, for artificial intelligence revenue forecast out through 2025. Now, we all know the dangers of extrapolation because this is a data crowd. So we can debate the kind of the growth rates. But I guess the point is that with this kind of growth, this is one of the fastest growing segments in IT today. So it's certainly getting a lot of attention. So let's talk about the enterprise. Now, much of the data in enterprises today resides in relational databases, and SQL is one of the most common workloads. So if you consider that moving data is expensive, if you're going to move data from where it is to another execution engine, run machine learning or graph algorithms on that, move it back, there's a cost associated with that. In addition, enterprises have invested a lot in the training for their personnel, both database administrators, analysts. So they have an investment in SQL that they don't want to throw away. Also, there's a lot of BI tools today that work on SQL. So there's a whole ecosystem of these business intelligence tools that analysts and companies use to run their business day to day, right? So SQL is really kind of at the core of a lot of businesses today, especially the Fortune 2000 companies. I guess one additional point to mention on SQL is that if you're bringing a new execution engine into the enterprise today, there's a lot of policy related issues associated with that. So it's not that easy to swap out a relational database or SQL for other kinds of platforms. So this brings us to Apache MADlib. So Apache MADlib is a scalable in-database machine learning library. It's open source, incubating at Apache Software Foundation. And it runs on Greenplum database, it runs on Postgres, it also runs on Apache Hawk, which is a SQL on Hadoop engine, open source SQL on Hadoop product. And the main advantages of MADlib really are around scale and performance. So if you have data that fits in memory on a single node, then there's a lot of other options for you out there. There are, you know, R libraries. There's a lot of good Python libraries like scikit-learn. But if you have very large data sets, then Apache MADlib, that's sort of what it was designed for, because it takes advantage of the massively parallel processing capabilities of Greenplum database. So one of the examples that Anirudh is going to speak to us about later in the era of cybersecurity involve these very, very large data sets that really don't fit in memory on a single node. So that's what this technology is for. A short history lesson. Apache MADlib came out of work that was done at UC Berkeley by a very smart gentleman by the name of Joe Hellerstein, together with some architects from EMC and Greenplum. So that was in 2011. Since that time, there's been a good collaboration between Greenplum and now Pivotal, as well as the academic community. So we've had participation from Stanford University, University of Wisconsin-Madison has been a really strong partner, as well as the University of Florida. So this collaboration has sort of led to the project that we have today, which is Apache MADlib. It's always been open source, but in the last year or so, it's been an Apache Software Foundation. So it's pretty mature. It's a very comprehensive library, which has been developed over the last 6 years or so. And it can really solve for a whole, you know, range of practical real-world use cases in machine learning. So there's something of the order of 35 to 40 principal algorithms. So a little bit more about the features of Apache MADlib. I mentioned the parallelism. It's really been designed to take advantage of the massively parallel processing architecture of Greenplum database. And the algorithms themselves are implemented on a kind of case-by-case basis. Like, there's no general way to take a machine learning algorithm and automatically distribute it across the cluster. You know, it has to be done kind of algorithm by algorithm, and there's various degrees of parallelism that you can get depending on the algorithm. Some algorithms are very amenable to parallelization, like, say, linear regression, logistic regression. Others are harder to parallelize, like time series data, for example. So that's sort of the art and science of the folks that work on this product, is like, how can you realize these scale-out machine learning algorithms on in a cluster. The idea behind scalability, it's kind of stating the obvious, but what you want to do is you want to be able to add nodes as your data set scales, right? So you don't want to have to change your software when you deploy it on larger clusters. So the idea behind Apache MADlib is you could develop your software on Postgres on your laptop, and then take that exact same software and then deploy it on a 50-node Greenplum cluster. You wouldn't have to change anything at all. So the idea behind better predictive accuracy, so data scientists do not want to sample the data, because that can lead to lower accuracy models. So even if you have very large data sets, sometimes if you have high cardinality dimensions like user ID or machine ID, and then you're building models on a per user basis, if you don't use all of your data, if you're sampling it, then you can end up with sparsity problems for those dimensions. So we really want to use all of the data for building our models. So it's an Apache Software project, it's incubating. We're just doing our fourth release, probably in the next week or so. Apache Software Foundation is a great place to develop software. We've had a lot of good contributions from the community over the last year or so since we've moved there. And it's the community-driven model is great, and Pivotal sort of at the core of that. So let's look now about kind of how it fits into the Greenplum database. This is a kind of look at what a distributed parallel database looks like. So we have our master server, and here we have one mirror. We have a network interconnect, and it's talking to multiple segment servers, and segment servers is Greenplum speak for worker nodes. So we load in our data from external sources. The data lives on the segments. So you have SQL coming in here. It comes through the master server. That's where the query planning is done. That's where the cost-based query optimization is done. It dispatches the query to the worker nodes, and that's where the query execution happens. That's where the query processing happens, and that's where the data is, right? So that's the idea, kind of in a nutshell, for massively parallel processing. So this tries to show how MADlib fits into that picture. It's kind of a layer on top of Greenplum, but it also has shared objects which are actually embedded in the database. So there's MADlib takes SQL, there's an R interface and a Python interface. So there's a layer that does input validation and pre-processing, which is a Python layer. So also within the database are these in-database functions for machine learning, statistics, math, graph, and various utility functions, right? So you can think of MADlib as both a layer above as well as shared objects embedded in the database. And the reason that this is done is for scalability reasons that I was talking about before. So what we're very careful when we build a new algorithm to do scalability testing along kind of the main dimensions of interest. One obviously being size of data, but that's not the only one. So this is showing linear regression scalability on Greenplum and Apache Hawk. So the x-axis here is the number of rows in the database. Goes up to, in this case, we're looking up to 100 million. And this is the runtime in seconds for the linear regression, right? So it's running on an 8-node Greenplum cluster. So this serves to demonstrate that we're looking for linear scalability with data size. So linear regression is it's not an iterative algorithm. There's a closed form solution for it, so you can solve it quite quickly. This is sort of an equivalent problem for logistic regression. Logistic regression is an iterative algorithm, the way that it's realized here. So you can see the run times now are in the hundreds of seconds. Before we were looking at, you can solve for 100 million rows in less than 50 seconds. In logistic regression, 100 million rows takes, 700 seconds in this case, because it's a different kind of algorithm. So we spend a lot of time thinking about how to realize algorithms so that they have predictable scale, because that's often what users are asking us or customers are asking us, if we use data size of this big, like, does it work? How long is it going to take? This is an example for a graph algorithm that we're running. It's called single source shortest path. I'll give a demo of this one shortly. But it shows that if you have 500,000 vertices and 100 edges per vertex, so this means about 50 million edges, then in about 50 seconds you can run the shortest path algorithm. Apache MADlib has an R interface and a Python interface, but at its core, it's a SQL-based machine learning library. So this is an example of what it looks like. It's a declarative function within a select statement. So here we're training a linear regression model to predict house prices. You specify an input table where your data is, an output table where you want your model to end up, what you're trying to predict. So this is the dependent variable that you're trying to predict. These are the features in your data. So in this case, property tax, number of bathrooms, size of data, you want to have as your independent variables or your features. And in this case, we want to predict by bedroom. So this is kind of a toy example, but it serves to show that you can use the grouping capability as well, so that if you want to build a model by number of bedrooms, or the cybersecurity example, if you want to build a model by user, you can group by user, and you're actually effectively building multiple models with a single select statement. And associated with training the model, there's a prediction. The idea, and there's a concept in data science of having historical data to train your model, and then using new new data in order to do prediction, right? So for every training function, there is a prediction function. And the prediction function takes the model that was built here and applies it to predict, in this case, house prices. So that's sort of what the look of it is with respect to SQL statements. Before we get to the demo, I'll just show you a little bit about the execution flow. So I won't go into too much detail about this, but I sort of wanted to show you how it flows through the system. So if you're on a client machine here, which could be a notebook like a Jupyter notebook or Apache Zeppelin or PGAdmin, PSQL, this client then passes a SQL to a database server. The database server then calls a stored procedure on the master. And the stored procedure, inside that stored procedure, is this idea of an aggregation. And the aggregation is the key to the way the machine learning algorithms are implemented across the segments, right? So this is all happening here on the query processing is all happening on these segments, these worker nodes, right? So that's sort of the flow. When you have a result set, then it's passed back to the client. So if we were to drill into this picture just a little bit here, I wanted to show you how it works on iterative model execution. So remember I mentioned there's something called a stored procedure, which is running on the master. A stored procedure defines something called an aggregation. So we're going to loop here. This is in Python. So we're going to loop here until we've converged on our model. So what this model aggregation actually does then is after initialization, it runs a model update on each of the segments. So it's called a transition function, which comes from the Postgres heritage of Greenplum. So this operates on tuples within the database, or batches of tuples. It builds this transition function. It merges those states from all of the segments. So you have this data parallel operation going here. It merges the function. There's a merge function which combines everything. And then there's a final function. The final function computes a final output of some kind. And then depending on whether it's converged or not, it will broadcast. If it hasn't, it will rebroadcast the update of the model, and then it will run again. So this iterative model execution is this idea of transition function, merge function, final function, is the way it works in the context of Greenplum database. Most distributed systems have some sort of equivalent, right? There's some sort of idea about, dividing up the workload across of the cluster and collecting or averaging your results. So this is what the stack looks like, kind of different view of what we were just looking at. The SQL interface, this high-level iteration controller, which is in Python, which we were looking at in the previous slides. The actual algorithms themselves are realized in C++. So those functions I was talking about, which are actually doing the machine learning computations, those are done in C++. right? And they call directly into the CAPI of the database. Okay, so let's do a quick demo here. Okay, is that readable? Not that readable. Okay. So I thought I would do three quick examples, a predictive analytics example, a utilities example, and a graph example to give you kind of an idea of the different kinds of you know, things you can do in Apache MADlib. So we'll start. So I'm using a Jupyter notebook here, which is this is something that a lot of data scientists use quite frequently. Another one is Apache Zeppelin, which is a fairly common notebook that that folks use for developing models. And it's convenient because it allows us to mix both SQL and Python and use plotting libraries and things within the notebook. So I have a SQL extension loaded here. I'm running the MADlib 1.10. So this is, we'll do the house prediction example that we were showing before. So I'm going to load some data. This is what the input table looks like. So it has columns for property tax, number of bedrooms, number of bathrooms, the price of the house, size of the house, and then size of the lot. So this is sort of a toy example that kind of serves to demonstrate how it works. So we want to build a single model for the whole data set. So the way we do that is similar to the example I showed you before. We have a source table. We have an output table which will hold our model. This is the dependent variable we're trying to predict, price. And this is the independent variables, the tax, the bath, number of bathrooms, and the size. So this is building a single model on the whole data set, right? So now I'm looking at the output for that model. So these are the coefficients of that model. And there's four of them here because we have three features. We have three dependent variables, or independent variables rather, and we have an intercept, right? So if you remember your high school math or undergraduate math where you're drawing a straight line between a number of data points. Linear regression is similar to that. It works in higher dimensions, but that's kind of the idea. So we have the coefficients of our model, some other statistics around kind of goodness of that model, and then we want to use that to predict. So I'm going to use my prediction, and I'm going to use the coefficients which are coming from that model. So if I run that model, then this is the original data I had, and this is the predicted price. So I'm feeding actually the same data back in, which is not normally what you would do. You would be predicting on new data. But if I feed the same features in, then it's predicting, whereas the actual price was 50,000, it's predicting 53,000, 85,000 is 109. So, I mean, it's not a great data, but it's a tiny, not a great model, but it's a tiny data set, right? So it's fitting a straight line to that data. If I want to build a different model, then I can actually group by bedroom. So I'm running the same thing, but I'm saying I want to build a different model for one bedroom, a two bedroom, and a three bedroom. And I will run that model then. And now, as you can see, I have different models, so I still have the four coefficients, but I have a different ones for four bedrooms, three bedrooms, two bedrooms. I guess there's no one bedroom in this data set. So then when I do my prediction, I will get different predictions, but what it will do is it will consider this feature in the input and use a different model for that feature. So this is kind of a common thing that you want to do instead of putting a loop around everything and building multiple models, then you can do it by a simple group by. So that's an example of a simple prediction kind of algorithm. Let's look at a utility. So in this example, maybe go back here for a second. We want to operate on these things called categorical variables. So categorical variables are discrete, unordered, qualitative kind of variables. And here's some example. Hair color is one. Blood type is another. State of the union. So the reason I say they're unordered is because one hair color is not actually better than another. Well, you may have a preference and think one is better than the other, but from the data science perspective, you know, there's a lot of data out there that's in this categorical kind of form that you want to use. But if you just, you know, put that into a table, then there's not a lot of models that could actually operate on this, right? So you have here, her name is Jane. She has black hair, she has A+ blood type, she lives in California. Raj has brown hair, O-negative blood type, lives in New York. Many predictive models can't use this. Some can, like decision trees, but many of them can't. So you need to operate on them. And the standard way to do that is something called encoding. So encoding categorical variables then actually creates multiple features from a single feature. So in this case, in the case of hair color, whereas before we had black, brown, red, what have you, now we've sort of broken these out. So we have a feature which is black hair color, a feature for brown, a feature for red. Likewise for blood types, A+, O-negative, A-, right? So then we want to be able to build tables like this because then I can feed this into a regression model or another kind of model. This is a simple example. There's various permutations on this, but let's look at how we might do that in MADlib. So let's load some data. So this is a standard data set that you may have seen. This is for abalone. So there's the main features here are gender, male, female, I for indeterminate, I think. Length, diameter, height, number of rings in the abalone. So if we use then a MADlib utility function called encode categorical variables, right? What this allows us to do then, and here I've said I want to encode the gender, what I end up here with then is instead of a single column for like female, male, or whatever, it's broken out now, so I have one for female, one for indeterminate, and one for male. And then I have a value for the associated one. Now, data scientists are kind of demanding in that they have very many options that they want to do on that. They don't want to do it just the simple way, just a simple way like that. Sometimes they want to encode nulls. So we support things like being able to encode a null. So if there's null data, then we can actually call that out and encode that. Sometimes they want to encode just the top values. So the top, in this case, the top two genders and 50% of their rings, right? So we kind of do that encoding. So there's multiple kind of options on that, including things like array output. So instead of putting things into a table in a wide column, because you could have like super wide columns, then in this case we put it in an array and then build a dictionary on that so that you can look up into the array. So the next example I want to give for, actually maybe I'll do the graph one since we're running a bit short on time. So graph is something new that we've added to Apache MADlib. And this idea behind single source shortest path. So the way that it works is that, so this is a simple graph. It has vertices or nodes on it. It has edges on it that connect them. This is a digraph. There, it's a directional graph because there's a direction to the edges. And in this case, the edges have values that, that mean something. So the single source shortest path algorithm, what it tries to do is, given a graph and a starting point, it finds the shortest path to all of the other nodes in the database, or all of the other nodes in the graph. And in this case, say from A to F, it's highlighted in blue, from A, C, E, D, F is the shortest path between vertices A and F, as opposed to going through B, because it minimizes the edge weights. And so you might ask, well, what is this useful for? Actually, shortest path is actually used for a ton of different things. It's actually a pretty versatile algorithm. It's used for vehicle routing, navigation, in a social network, looking at degrees of separation between people. In a telecommunications network, looking at like minimum delay path in the network. It's used for plant and facility layout, VLSI design. Lots of things you can do with shortest path and kind of variants on shortest path. Right. So we have a graph representation in MADlib with a vertex table and an edge table. We'll go into that. But so if we load a graph, which is a fairly simple little graph here, which has got seven nodes in it and a bunch of connections between these vertices and edge weights, then we can call a shortest path algorithm. And with the shortest path, so what we do on shortest path is we specify the vertex and edge tables. We specify the source. Where do we want to start from? And then an output table, so it will dump all of the shortest paths there. Right, so this is a output table. This is saying from node 0 to 0 is obviously 0 because there's no travel. From 0 to 1, the weight is 1. From 0 to 2, the weight is 1. 0 to 3, the weight is 2. Right, so this is the shortest path, the kind of the raw form of the shortest path output. And from there, you can look into that and get, you know, a particular path that you're interested in, for example. So we're looking for the route to path 6 from 1, and it goes, or 0 goes 0, 2, 5, 6, right? So there's various kind of other options on that, but it kind of gives you the idea of being able to do graph processing in a relational database. Without having to go to like a specialized database like Neo4j or Titan or something like that. Yes. Yes. Yeah. So Mahout is, I don't know that Mahout has graph algorithms per se. Yeah, Mahout is a fairly it's not as popular anymore, but it's a it's an open source machine learning library. I don't think it's distributed, though. I think it's single node. So Mahout would have much smaller data sizes that you could operate on. Don't hear that much about Mahout anymore, actually. So maybe just to kind of finish up here, I did want to mention something about the R interface. So MATLAB is a SQL-based language, but this is a relatively recent survey for popular data science languages. So the top ones are R, Python, and SQL. And in fact, the two that are growing here are SQL, at least compared to 2015 survey, are SQL and R. So what we provide within Apache MADlib is an R interface that allows you to work in a familiar R client, but then have the ability to do very large data sets in the database. Right, so instead of instead of writing SQL code like we were writing before, you could work in data frames in your R studio. You could use other R packages you're interested in. But when it comes to doing operations on large data sets, then you could call the MADlib algorithms, and then they would run in database. And the way that works is that we're sitting here on the left side working in our R client. We call a MADlib function from there, and then it's converted to SQL to execute in the database. So it runs in the database here, and then the computation results then are sent back to the client. Right? So the kind of the heavy lifting happens on the database side. So finally, I wanted to say a word about what's coming up in the future. These are the things that we're thinking about. It's an open source project, so you know people in the community can suggest and work on anything. These are the things that we're thinking about for 2017. A lot more in graph analytics. There's a class of graph algorithms that run really well in relational databases. Not all of them do. There are some that involve hierarchical data, that involve multiple joins for relations that aren't that amenable to running in relational in MPP databases even. But these ones are page rank, connected components, all pair shortest paths, centrality measures associated with that, graph diameter, graph cut. So this class of things we want to work on. We also want to do neural nets and deep learning, including GPU support. So we've started some kind of initial designs and discussions around that, given the power of those kinds of algorithms. We want to support boosted machines, which is a way of doing kind of ensemble modeling. So improvements to existing algorithms, improvements to the Python interface. So this gives you sort of a look forward to what we're doing for the next few months. And so we've done 4 releases this year, or in the last year or so, and then we're moving towards top level status in the Apache Software Foundation. Okay, so that was the introduction to MADlib. I'd like to hand it over to my colleague, Anna Root, who is going to speak to us then about the cybersecurity use case in particular.
Thanks, Frank. My name is Anirudh. I'm from the data science team at Pivotal. So I'm going to talk about how to use data science for cybersecurity applications. Frank has given a very good introduction of some of the algorithms that are there in MADlib and which can be run on a Greenplum database. So I'm going to talk about how we can use some of those algorithms to solve like real life problems, one of them being cybersecurity, right? So the cost of cybercrime is increasing nowadays. The average cost for the US enterprise is approximately $16 million per year, and the cost is growing at 15% CAGR over the last 3 years. Any given cybercrime can cost more than that. And for example, the Target's hack almost costed the company approximately $162 million. The cost is not just financial, but also it's based on the reputation, right? The data leakage and also the sensitive information that's leaked due to a cyber attack. Nowadays, perimeter defense is inadequate in the sense that we're just securing the perimeter of a network is not sufficient anymore. Like most of the hacking or most of the malware arises from within the network, right? So the idea of perimeter becomes obsolete, and we need better threat detection methods inside the network where we can analyze the large volume of data that's being generated within the network and try to come up with solutions that can make use of an analytic platform like Greenplum that can analyze petabytes and terabytes of data and detect threats, needle in a haystack kind of anomalies in the data, right? So one of the important problem in cybersecurity is lateral movement detection or insider threat detection, right? Where we are trying to detect bad guys within the network and how they are moving within the network. So this is something called an APT kill chain. APT is nothing but advanced persistent threat, where the threat is persisting within the network and it is being left unnoticed for a long amount of time, right? So the first place where an attacker comes into the network is by a phishing and a zero-day attack, where probably they can target a bunch of users by sending an email or by sending a malicious piece of code, so that whenever they open that code or when they click on that email, the software gets downloaded in the network, and then that's where the malicious piece of software comes into the network, right? So once the user's machine is compromised, the bad guy is accessing the computer by some tools like the Poison Ivy tool. And then the bad guy has access to the network. And then he tries to do lateral movement. Lateral movement is nothing but trying to access other computers within the network, right? He's laterally moving, and he gets access to other important users and assets within the organization. Then what happens is he tries to gather data within the network, and then exfiltration, where data is exfiltrated out of the network. So this is the typical APT kill chain. What we're interested in detecting the lateral movement, right? Once we are within the network, how can we detect if there is some suspicious activity happening within the network? So lateral movement detection on a high level is to identify anomalous user level access to various servers within the organization. That servers could be either computers or databases or any critical assets within the organization, right? So how do we solve this problem? There is a lot of data being generated within the network, like whenever a user logs onto a computer, right? Then you get information like what has he authenticated against, whether it's a laptop or a desktop, whether it's a failed authentication or the successful authentication, and who is the person who logged in, and whether once he's logged in, whether he's accessing other computers in the network and things like that, right? So there's a lot of data that's being generated by people within an organization every day. So imagine how much data is there if you're looking at an organization consisting of, like, say, thousands of employees and having thousands of servers. Like each user can access a subset of the servers, and then they generate logs from the network by accessing that data, right? So we need to look into the people and the machines, and there's a lot of data, and we need to look into each user's behavior. We have to see how it compares with his past, and then whether it's different from what he has done in the past. And also even for the network as a whole, not just a user, but if a user belongs to some department, we can look into his department behavior as such, like his peers, like what are they doing? How does his behavior differ from his peers and things like that? So there are a lot of scenarios why this can arise, where there's an ill-intentioned activity by a legitimate employee, or the user's account has been compromised, or there's an access policy abuse that's happening, right? The business value is we are able to do focused monitoring on the assets within the organization, and there is advanced system and event management alert queue prioritization that's happening, right? So typically, in order to solve this problem, first step is to aggregate all the logs that are there that arise from the network, right? There could be a variety of logs, like Active Directory logs, which show about the authentication of the user, and similarly, Active Directory metadata, which give information about the servers, about the users, and also the LDAP activity, like how is authenticating, whether it's whether it's a failure, whether it's a success, and things like that. So there are a variety of logs. We need to create a place where we can store that logs at first. So Greenplum is one of the solutions that we have used for solving this problem in the past, right? So once we have the security data lake, as I call it, then we need to create a place where we can kind of parse that data, right? The parsing can happen using From the semi-structured data, you convert that into a structured format. Or we can directly work with the semi-structured data in using Hawk, which is basically a SQL engine for data stored in Hadoop, right? So once we have that parsed data or structured or unstructured, semi-structured data, that we build an ensemble of models, right? Like it could be like regression or recommendation system or a user behavior model, which accesses all or part of the data. And based on the scores from these ensemble of models, we kind of score each of the users based on their anomaly score. So at the end of at the end of the day or at the end of the week, you get a list of users who are basically bad. Like each of the models scores those user activity and then says, okay, at the end of the week, so these are the list of top 25 or 50 users who are kind of doing some anomalous activity within the network, right? So so we need a platform, apart from these models, there could be also graph-based models. So Greenplum here, as Frank was mentioning, is able to do everything, like the basic machine learning algorithms, the standard ones, like the regression and principal component analysis. Yep.
So in order to train the regression,
yeah.
What's the training set that shows the expected output? Meaning, how do you know?
Yeah.
What's your
dependent? Sure, sure. I'm actually getting to that in the next slide. Yeah. Yeah. So the thing is, using Greenplum, we can do all these machine learning algorithms and also do graph-based analytics, right? So to answer your question, how does the regression work, right? Say if you're building a regression-based model to detect this kind of activity. One simple way to do this is to identify users with unusual variation in the number of servers accessed over time. So in this case, the dependent variable would be like the number of servers a user accesses, and the independent variable would be the time, right? So if you have kind of a regression model based on week of the year, and then the number of servers, right? Say you're plotting those two and trying to fit a regression line based on those two, and one way to see if the user activity is if there's a spike in that activity, right? That is an indication that something suspicious is happening for the user. Like he doesn't generally access so many servers, but suddenly there's a spike in the activity. So one way to do that is fit a regression line for that user, and then find the slope of that regression line. So if the slope for if you kind of find the subset of users with a very high positive slope, that kind of indicates that there's a spike in activity, and there could be possible anomalous activity happening over there. So imagine. So if you have like 10,000 users, we build a regression model for each of the users. So all the 10,000 regression models have to be running in parallel, right? So if that is happening sequentially, that'll take a lot of time. While if they're being run in parallel, like grouping by the username, as Frank just mentioned, build a regression model and then group by user. So for each user, you get a separate regression model which is run in parallel. It hardly takes a few seconds to get this. So this is like a very quick way of getting initial insights on how user is accessing servers. Right. So if we want to go into more granular details, like not just looking into how many servers is a user accessing, we also want to look at what servers is the user accessing, right? We need to build a historical profile for each user. Like we can look into multiple features, like the servers being accessed, the IP addresses that the user is logging in from, and the geographical information if the user is doing a remote login, right? How is it changing over time? Say, suppose I'm logging from India one day, and suppose I'm logging from US the other day, and things like that, right? So that is kind of a discrepancy. So we can include a lot of features into an advanced model, not just a regression model, which I'll be talking about. So the model also should be able to stress on the individual user job. Like if he belongs to, if he's a data scientist, then his job, based on his job profile, his activity would be different compared to a person in sales, right? Or an IT professional who does network patches and software patches, and the number of servers he accesses generally are higher than a data scientist on a usual basis, right? So that should also stress on the individual user or job role. And some of the multiple features you can generate to reduce the false alarms. One is, instead of just looking into a server, you can aggregate the servers to the server group, right? Like if a user touches one printer versus another printer, that's not much anomalous. But if you know that a user who is generally accessing printers and normal databases suddenly touches a production server, that's something more anomalous, right? So that kind of information you can get from the server group, like what group does the server belong to, right? Similarly, you can incorporate the server criticality information, like add weights to the servers based on how critical the server is. And like assign more weight to less popular servers and IP addresses. Like printers are generally given a less weight, right? And also we can use something like a recommendation system, which I'll be talking in the next slides, to suggest servers to user based on their job roles and based on the peers. That can help reduce false positives in the model, right? So once we have this kind of user behavior matrix that's being created, then there are different ways of detecting anomalies, right? One of the algorithms that we use is principal component analysis. PCA is a dimensionality reduction technique, where if you have a multidimensional vector, by using PCA, we can find out the components in the multidimensional vector which capture most of the variance in the data, right? Say for example, you have this matrix over here on the bottom, where for each week, given the server index, you know what a user accesses. How many times in a week does the user access a particular server, right? So the first over here, it says that on week one, this particular user has accessed the server for 2 days in the week. Similarly, he has accessed server two for 4 days in the week and things like that. So if you create this user behavior matrix over enough history, say for 6 months of data, of the history for the data, and then given a new week, we compare that with the old matrix and try to see how that new vector deviates from the matrix, from the user behavior matrix, right? For that, we could use principal component analysis to do this detection. Like, how does the new vector compare with the matrix, right? So one way of doing principal component analysis, scoring using principal component analysis, is something called a reconstruction error-based method, where you have a training data, in this case, the user behavior matrix, which shows what servers a user touches every week, right? On that, you run the principal component analysis, the PCA algorithm, and you calculate the principal dimensions. That means which are the components in that matrix which capture most of the variance. So those will be the principal dimensions, right? So now given a new test vector, that is user data for a new week, this would be the test vector. Given the training data and the test data, like we have training data is the data that we use in the past, in the history, and the test data is the current week of data, right? So we can project that test vector onto these principal components, and then we can reconstruct this test vector based on the training data. So we got a reconstructed test vector. So we are trying to see how much of the variance is being captured in the test vector from the principal dimensions of the training data. So if there is a lot of difference between the test vector and the reconstructed test vector, that means the test vector can't be really described by the training data. So there would be a huge difference between the two vectors. And that difference is what can be used as an anomaly score to detect if the new data is different from the past data, right? So PCA can be run in MADlib. So there is a parallelized version implemented in MADlib, and we can directly use PCA in, and it runs very fast for running this kind of algorithm, right? So there's another way of scoring using PCA as well, which is called oversampling PCA, where once you have the training data and the test data, in this case, the training data is the user behavior matrix and the test data is the new data for the user. What we can do is run the PCA, principal component analysis, and find the first principle vector. The first principle vector is nothing but the vector which captures the maximum variation in the data. So similarly, now take the test data and then oversample the test data. That means oversampling is a way in which you're repeating the test data multiple times. Right? Once you oversample the test data, you again run the PCA and then find the first principle vector based on these oversample data. So once we have these two vectors, we can find the difference in the angle between them, which can be used as an anomaly score to see how whether the new test data is different from the training data. So as an example, say for example, if these blue points are the normal data and this red point is an over, if this is the test data, and if you oversample the test data, so for example, for the training data, this green line is the first principle vector, right? But if you oversample this same data, this principle vector does not change much. On the other hand, if this was an anomaly, and if you oversampled this test data, then the direction between the initial principle vector and the final principle vector changes a lot. So what that means is if the test data is not within the training data space, then that will affect the principle component a lot. So that's one of the way to use principle component analysis for scoring based on the data, right? So most of you are familiar with R and Python, right? If you are really using R and Python excessively, like most of the team, most of the people in the data science team are really like to use R and Python. So here I show an R code to do principal component analysis. Like it's standard vanilla R code where you can import a library and then run R to do principal component analysis. Now, how do you parallelize that using something called a PLR? PLR is a programmable extension to R, and you can run PLR on Greenplum, right? So if you wrap this code that I showed previously into a wrapper function, as you can see, it starts with a drop function and then you create a function, and then your existing code just falls into those wrapper. And at the bottom, it says that it's language PLR. So once you wrap this vanilla R code using a PLR function, you would be able to basically run that in parallel on Greenplum database. So the Greenplum database, as was mentioned previously, has a master server and a segment servers, right? So once you're executing this PLR function, each of the segment nodes has R already installed on them. And each of those has, so when you're distributing the data, each of the user data is distributed across the segment servers. And when you're running that function, the model is being executed for each of the user data separately. That way you can parallelize this algorithm across the various segments in a very explicit manner. So this is how you can do explicit parallelization using PLR. So other model that we can use for this kind of a problem is like a recommendation model, right? What Netflix or Amazon is doing. It's recommending movies to you based on what others might like, right? Similarly, what you can do is you can recommend servers to users based on what other people in the organization are touching, right? Who are the other people who are similar to you in the organization? Based on that, you can actually recommend servers to a particular user and say that if this user is touching that server, since that server is already recommended to him, I don't have to worry much about that. It's based on his job profile and things like that. So for example, over here, by using the PCA model, on the left, you can see that the score was close to 50 on the test data. But when you actually recommended the servers on the right, we can decrease the weight for the recommended servers. So on the test data, if you see this G4 and G5 are the new servers that are being accessed by a user. What this is a heat map, right? This basically shows for each week, the user is actually accessing these 5 servers. But whenever there is a dark blue color over here, that means it says that he is accessing only those servers. But when it's black, it means the user is not accessing that server. So on the first week, the user accessed only G1, G2, and G5. Similarly, on the second week, he accesses G2 and G5. So, but if you can see on the last week, he accesses G4 and G3, which he hasn't accessed in the past. So based on these new servers that are appearing for the user, you get a very high anomaly score for the user. But if the recommendation engine, when we ran the recommendation engine, these G3 and G4 servers were actually recommended to the user. So you can see that they are grayed out in the test data. That way, the score for the user has decreased in the test data. So this is one of the model where you're looking into recommendation, making use of a recommendation engine to reduce the false positives in the model, right? So other ways of approaching this problem is also looking this in the form of a graph. The advantages of using, using historical data, we can actually look into where the user is logging in from and what the user is logging into. So whenever a user access starts from a particular machine and logs into another machine, then you can create a, like you can use those servers as the nodes, and you can create an edge between those two machines, right? So for example, there's a typical behavior of a user where he logs in from his home machine and then VPNs to his work machine and then starts touching a whole bunch of servers. Then one of the anomalous behavior that we can detect using graph-based anomalous techniques is if the user from his home starts directly touching a database with financial information, right? So that is not very typical for that user. That's very anomalous for the user. So here you can like you're looking into how you can model this as a graph. And as Frank mentioned, we can use a lot of graph-based algorithms to detect if this is anomalous or not for that particular user. So the advantage of modeling this as a graph is that the graph models are sensitive to the direction and the order and the frequency in which user access server compared to modeling it as a matrix, right? So Fortune 100 companies are leveraging Pivotal to tackle enterprise-wide security analytics, right? So the challenge is that we need to gain timely insights within of the threats that are occurring within the network, right? So the solution is we need a platform that can store large volumes of data, and we need a platform where we can analyze this data using machine learning algorithms in a scalable fashion. Say, for example, being able to use MADlib or being able to use open source algorithms like R and Python in a scalable manner. And also, we leverage our data science expertise at Pivotal to solve some of the problems that arise in the security space, like identifying fraud, unapproved file sharing, and things like that. Right. So just to summarize, why do you use Pivotal for security analytics? So we have the Pivotal data science team has expertise and partnership with customers to identify high-value use cases to solve their problems. And also we have tight integration to analytic tools like MADlib, like Frank has mentioned, that run in database across all of the data. And also we have a solution that's scalable. Like as your data size increases, you can actually increase the number of nodes, the Greenplum nodes, to be able to scale your algorithms for as the data volume keeps increasing, right? So that is that's the reason why Pivotal or the Greenplum database is actually pretty useful for solving security analytics problems. So I just want to give more information, like additional resources, where you can find more information about our data science team and some of the problems that we are solving, both in cybersecurity space and also across different verticals. We have a data science blog, which is blog.pivotal.io and channels and datascience.pivotal. And also we can, how we help our customers, our engagement strategy, or how we involve with customers to solve their problems. And also we have some webinars that keep happening all the time. We have a webinar, the next webinar is on using data science to detect healthcare fraud. Also there are links for Apache MADlib and Pivotal Greenplum Sandbox, which were shown previously. I guess that's all I have for now. Thank you. Thank you everyone for being here and also who are present online.